Good morning and welcome to the 12th meeting in 2023 of the Economy and Fair Work Committee. I've received apologies from Michelle Thompson this morning and John Mason is attending in her place. Our first item of business is a decision to consider the evidence received during the inquiry and correspondence from the Public Audit Committee in private at the next meeting. Is that agreed? Yes, thank you. Okay, so our next item of business is the seventh evidence session of our inquiry into a just transition for the Grangemouth area. I welcome Mary McAllen, Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Just Transition, who is joined by Chris Briceland, Energy Infrastructure Team Leader, who is joining us remotely this morning, Katrina Lang, Deputy Director for Climate Change Division, Andy McCall, Industrial Just Transition Planning Team Leader, and Liam Middleton, the Head of Critical Energy Infrastructure and Commercial Projects, all with the Scottish Government. And as always, if witnesses and members could keep their questions and answers as short and concise as possible, that would be helpful. And I'll invite the Cabinet Secretary to make a short opening statement.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm very pleased to be here. First time in front of your committee, and first time doing so in my new role as Cabinet Secretary for Net Zero and Just Transition. This government is committed to realising what we see as a really exceptional opportunity before us to deliver a growing green economy, and we set this out as one of the primary missions in our prospectus last week. In my own section of that prospectus, I set out my commitment to working to reduce our carbon emissions, to doing so with the urgency that the climate emergency demands of us, but to do so fairly and in a way that takes people, workers, communities with us. So we welcome this inquiry with the specific focus on Grangemouth and the just transition planning that's going on there. Grangemouth is a cluster of significant industrial importance to Scotland, and we see it as being integral to our future net zero economy and society. Our industrial emissions in Scotland have fallen by over 10 million tonnes of CO2 between 1990 baseline and 2020. However, the industrial sector of today accounts for over 20% of Scotland's total greenhouse gas emissions. But that's why we announced in our programme for government that work is underway for a dedicated and focused Grangemouth Just Transition Plan. The plan will be place-based, it's regional, it will be nuanced, it will have differences from the other plans that we're setting out, and it will chart a vision to 2045 for the cluster. I was pleased to be able to visit Grangemouth recently, and perhaps we'll get on to discussing some of that, because I know that the committee did as well. But we are right at the beginning of this process, so I think the work that you have been doing will be really helpful in informing much of what we continue to do as we develop that plan. But I'll leave it there and we can move to questions. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thank you, Cabinet Secretary. Maybe you could expand a bit more on the Just Transition Plan for the Grangemouth area in terms of timescales. You have recognised the committee are doing work into this that will look to inform the government's work, but can you give an indication of when the draft plan will be ready?
Yes, so as I say, we are at the beginning of the process, and I should say officials that are with me here today, they are part of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, and the Grangemouth Future Industry Board will be they, as senior officials on it, will be the leading force behind that. And I would just put on record that our chair of the Future Industry Board couldn't be with us today, unfortunately, Convener. We weren't able to accommodate his personal commitment. But there's phases to this. So phase one is first half of 2023 into the second half of the year, and two of the main pieces of work there will be a baseline study to map the current economic situation at Grangemouth. That will look at GVA, emissions, employment, and it will also identify touch points to for interaction with the community. And the other part of phase one, which again is that portion of this year, is setting out the vision for 2045, and some of the aspects of that in our plan is that when we have completed both the baseline and work on the vision, we should be able to get a memorandum of understanding with stakeholders to agree to our vision. So that's phase one. And then phase two, which is the second half of this year and the beginning of 2045, will be us setting out the actions to deliver on that vision that was developed in 2023. And then we're aiming for publication in spring 2024.
Spring 24. Thank you. That's helpful. You mentioned the leadership board. There might be other members have questions on that, because we understand the board doesn't contain business representatives. It's quite public sector focused. But I'm going to leave that to other members, because I wanted to ask about the Just Transition Commission, who we heard from last week. There is their main comments recently have been on the draft energy plan, and there has been an exchange of correspondence between themselves and the Scottish Government, and they have expressed a degree of frustration about their involvement in processes that have gone before. I understand a memorandum of understanding has now been agreed between the Commission and the Scottish Government. So how do you see their involvement in the draft Grangemouth plan as it comes forward? And do you want to say a bit about the memorandum of understanding and what your recognition of their role is?
Yeah, absolutely. So you'll appreciate I came into post 2-3 weeks ago, but in March 2023, so prior to my coming in, this memorandum of understanding was agreed between Scottish Government and Just Transition Commission, and it speaks to an agreed work plan. It speaks to ensuring that the Commission can see drafts at an earlier stage, earlier, admittedly, than I think they felt they have done to date. And it involved the appointment of a series of commissioners with specialist advice on different sectors. So I welcome that. I mean, I think we have to agree, and as with much that we do in the climate and nature emergencies to respond to them, the pace and scale of it is challenging. So I think it's right that we continue to seek to improve our relations with a body as important as the Just Transition Commission. So ultimately, they will. Their role is to support and to scrutinise both the creation and the monitoring of our Just Transition plans. I absolutely welcome their input on that. One of the first meetings that I had when I was appointed was with Jim Ski, and we will speak again very soon. I suppose ultimately, the Scottish ministers are the decision makers in all of this. But my intention, backed up by the MOU, is that the Just Transition Commission should have a very fulsome role in the development and monitoring of what we do.
I think the committee would welcome that, given the response to the draft energy plan was quite a detailed 8-4 point response, that if we can maybe see that kind of engagement at an earlier stage, the draft plans as they come forward maybe would increase the meaningfulness of the draft strategies as they come forward. Can I just maybe ask for you to reflect on the experience in Longannet? I mean, one of the reasons why we have reduced our emissions was the closure of the energy plant in Kincardine. And at the time, following that, the Just Transition Commission commented that while there had been success in reallocating jobs, there hadn't been the benefit brought, there wasn't evidence that the benefit was brought to the local community, and the local community hadn't been consulted. Is there lessons that the government can learn from what was seen as an opportunity for a Just Transition in Longannet that didn't appear to be realised? When we think about, I suppose, Grangemouth is kind of the next big place that will go through a similar kind of transition as what Kincardine went through, what are the lessons that have been taken from that experience?
Yeah, no, absolutely. There's many lessons to be drawn from that. And I should say, I think the focus on Grangemouth just now is absolutely right. And it is because of how its contribution to our economy and to everyday life in Scotland sits so closely beside its emissions reduction and what it's doing there. So if I have a vision for what we're seeking to do here, there's a sort of economy, jobs, emissions, or tripartite issues. My vision is that we retain the economic value, we retain and grow, I hope, jobs, retain and grow economic value, and drive down the emissions. And in terms of how we learn from previous experiences, and you talked about the community and workers there, I think that's why very early and meaningful engagement with communities, with workers and with their trade unions has been so important. And already, and Liam might want to say some more about this, but already there's been engagement to date. We have worked with Unite the Union. I met with union reps when I visited Grangemouth, obviously, we are looking to find ways to work with the STUC Just Transition Officers that we are funding. And another really important initiative for this specific area is that we have decided to fund a Grangemouth Community Engagement Officer to be that liaison between the Grangemouth community and what's happening in the cluster and what we are doing with the plan to make sure that the voice of people who live in the area, many of whom are employed at the site, are heard really loudly. But Liam, I don't know if there's anything to add to that, particularly with the experience of Llangannet.
Yeah, so thank you and good morning, committee. I think all I would say is reiterate that, albeit at quite an early stage, the work for our Grangemouth Just Transition Plan is very much underway. We have met with my colleague Andy leads the team that has started this engagement. We've met with all of the 8 larger businesses in the cluster to try and get their participation, their involvement, and secure their buy-in to the plan. As the Cabinet Secretary said, we're really focused on community engagement. I think that goes back to the sort of core of your question, perhaps what didn't happen in Llangannet and what we're trying to do at Grangemouth. So just to give you a flavour of how we've already started that, we, through our colleagues at SEPA, who work on the Grangemouth Future Industry Board with us, they facilitated a Greener Grangemouth community event. So we had members from the community along to put questions to our team in terms of explaining what a just transition was and how that would impact them, but most importantly, how you could involve them in that process. We've also taken participation into another sort of town hall community event, met with the Grangemouth Community Council, Grangemouth and Skinflats Community Council as well. And I think the big point there is, as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, is we are sort of taking sort of dedicated action to fund a specific role for someone in the community to engage with the just transition process. I think there can be sort of issues with capacity, funding. You know, we're all very busy individuals, but actually putting that resource into the community to give someone that the opportunity to engage with this work meaningfully is hopefully a welcome step.
Okay, thank you. Other members will ask questions more on community involvement. I'll now move over to Colin Beattie to be followed by Colin Smith.
Thank you, Convener. Cabinet Secretary, over a time, witnesses have suggested that involving the investor community early in the development of plans, there's an opportunity there to get a better understanding of what finance might be available and how to ensure policy and projects are aligned with the market's ability to deliver. How specifically will the Scottish Government use the Just Transition Plan to highlight and package projects in a way which will ensure that they are attractive to private investors?
Thank you. It's a really good point, and I suppose I've been reflecting myself in the last little while about the need for investment, not just in industrial decarbonisation, but in, as we all know, the all of the actions that we have to take on climate change across the piece. The price tag is eye-watering, and the public sector cannot afford to meet that alone. But in terms of government's role, I think it is about setting the correct regulatory framework, creating confidence in the market about our direction of travel, and facilitating, as you say, investment from the private sector, responsible investment, additional investment, investment with integrity, but investment nonetheless. So the creation of the Grangemouth Future Industry Board is an example in and of itself of governments providing that public sector clarity and direction of travel. The Just Transition Plan will be a very important addition to that, and we will work with industry. Liam mentioned we've already met with the 8 large businesses at the complex. We will also engage with smaller and medium-sized enterprises in the area as well. And that will create the confidence in the direction of travel to allow for investment. And it's already happening, is the final point I would make. For example, INEOS, their sustainability plan that they took me through when I met them is linked with our 2045 target, which is very welcome, and it includes over £1 billion of investment at Grangemouth. So you can see already where we're able to set the, this is where we're going, this is where our economy is going, we must decarbonise, but we will work with you. It gives confidence to investors, including those of the size of INEOS, to make the investments that are needed.
Cabinet Secretary, you very correctly said that this is an eye-watering cost that's going to have to be absorbed, and the public sector itself is not going to be able to meet that. Can the private sector meet it? I mean, we always hear that there's problems with people investing long-term, long-term capital, patient capital, all that sort of thing, which in part SNB was brought in to try and plug that gap. But we're talking about tens of billions of pounds here. Is there enough capital within Scotland or the UK or elsewhere? Everybody's going to be tapping into the capital that's available in order to develop their own climate change targets. Has any assessment been done as to what might be available over a period?
Thank you for the question. I'll just take the last bit first, and my colleagues might want to add to this, but I would expect those questions will inform some of that baseline economic analysis that we're doing as part of phase one of the Just Transition Plan. What is the lay of the land? But in terms of the wider point about availability of capital and investment, so I suppose globally, we recently had the IPCC AR6 report, and among all of the dire warnings that were in that about the climate catastrophe we're heading for, there was a sort of silver lining, which is that there is sufficient finance globally in order to fund the transition. So again, it brings us back to our role as government in making very clear that this is the way that Scotland's economy and society are going, and that we are open for investment of the right kind. Liam, I'm conscious you've asked for short answers, convener, but I just wonder if there's anything we want to add about investment in Scotland, and I know you work quite closely with some of the investment bodies already.
Yeah, so I think my first comment is I wouldn't sort of underestimate the significance of that £1 billion investment from INEOS. I think that is a major step towards the immediate cluster, the wider central belt, and then indeed Scotland's wider move towards net zero, and I'm sure we'll discuss that later today. I think two comments I would make, if that's okay, convener. The first one is on the sort of quantum of Scottish Government funds that we've got in place, and I know you've heard this through various sessions to date, our Just Transition Fund, our Energy Transition Fund. We have a £100 million capital programme as part of the Hydrogen Action Plan. And we've got a specific £60 million fund set aside to promote industrial decarbonisation as well. Now, to go back to Mr Beattie's question, they are not going to subsidise the whole transformation of Scotland's industry. That's going to take huge capital sums. But hopefully what that shows industry is that the government is willing to sort of embark on this endeavour with them jointly, create the conditions, perhaps be a co-investor. And that's something that we speak regularly to SNB about, is through the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. And then my final comment, just on the scale of major capital that we have to attract into Scotland, I think some of the geopolitical events are going to be hugely significant to that. So the Inflation Reduction Act in the United States putting almost £400 billion of subsidy to try and attract net zero investment in industries into the US. The European Union's Green Industrial Deal doing a similar mechanism through their Net Zero Act, and then importantly the minerals to try and meet that legislation and attract the supply chain and the businesses. And I think we're in quite an acute phase in the UK just now. We've seen, well, what's our response to that? I think the Chancellor has said that we'll see that in his autumn statement. But for example, the Chief Exec of the CCC has said that the next few months are really critical in terms of how we attract and lure that private investment into the UK. I think there's plenty of capital out there, but it's about trying to create the conditions and really show that we can funnel that into the UK and indeed Scotland.
I think that one of my concerns is if we do manage to attract the volumes of capital that are needed, obviously they will want a return on their capital. And that will be one of the most compelling reasons to invest. But outside of that, there's a great pressure on capital at the moment in order to be absorbed into the economy and grow the economy and so forth. Is the market capable of handling both at the moment?
Yeah, so I think it can be. I think we have to recognise the wider economic circumstances and inflationary pressures. Also responding from COVID as well, many really significant businesses, they've been in survival mode for the last few years, and I think that's fair. Previously, our approach was to try and encourage decarbonisation as a sort of, it almost felt when we engaged with businesses, it was a sort of discretionary capital programme for them, something that was nice to do. Mm-hmm. I think we're trying to move that narrative into that that could actually be an economic opportunity for businesses. So one of the main levers towards reducing emissions and industrial decarbonisation is energy efficiency. So if we can work with businesses to show that if you invest in the right industrial processes that improve the efficiencies of your plant, that so too will impact and hopefully improve the balance sheet as well. So it's trying to work with them to explain how net zero can be an investment proposition for them and also an economic opportunity.
Thank you. Let me just move on to the community and their involvement in the immediate Grangemouth area. There's been apparently lots of consultations in recent years with the local community, which is good, but they don't seem to have seen any tangible outcomes that are linked to these consultations, which is not good. How will the Scottish Government ensure that the co-design process leads to stakeholders, including the local community, feeling that they're being listened to and that policy will address their concerns?
This is, I think it's a really good question, and again I come back to that point that when we are trying to act with the pace and scale that the emergency demands of us, we have to make sure that in our efforts to respond in that way, we don't forget about the really basic, important fundamentals of very close and meaningful engagement, not just listening, but actually being able to demonstrate that what we heard was acted upon. And I'm absolutely determined that, you know, having come into this post and with the piece of work in front of us of the Grangemouth Just Transition Plan, that community involvement, community engagement and a clear line of sight of how the community have their views have been reflected in the plan should be very much part of it. And, you know, I make no apology for coming back to the point about us deciding to fund the employment of that community liaison, somebody from the area coming into this work to give that really invaluable insight as to what it means to live in the area, how you relate to the industrial complex, what you want to see it do for you in the future. And that won't just relate to the complex itself or the decarbonisation thereof. It will relate to what it feels like to live in the area, to travel around the area. You know, for example, we have the flooding issues ongoing in Grangemouth, and I know that that's a concern for many people. So I want to have as early and as broad a consultation as we possibly can, and it's my intention that we will be able to demonstrate exactly how views have been borne in mind and built into the plan.
But if we've got a track record of having, as some people said, heavily consulting the local community already, and we're going to have another consultation, surely at some point we've got to deliver something as a result of these. Otherwise, you're going to find disengagement from the local community.
Yes, absolutely. I don't blame any community for having consultation fatigue, but that doesn't mean we don't do it. So we have to do it. And as you say, we have to be able to demonstrate in fairly early course tangible ways in which it's been listened to and reflected upon. And I come back again to the point I mentioned to the convener initially about the phasing of this. I mean, this is not going to take long. We're talking about having a plan, a publication in spring next year. So by the middle of this year, we will be able to set out that economic baseline work that we have done. We will have set out the vision for 2045, taking into account what we've heard from the consultations that we've done, and then within by the time we get to spring next year, there will be a very tangible plan for the community, for workers, for industry, for us and the public sector bodies involved in the Future Industry Board to reflect upon.
Well, I welcome that and look forward to seeing that.
Thank you.
Colin Smith to be followed by Fiona Heslop.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning, Cabinet Secretary. The Grangemouth plan will be the first regional just transition plan. So can I ask how it will differ from the sectoral plans that have been published, and how specifically, I suppose, how will you measure success? We know that any energy transition is likely to reduce emissions, but what we've seen in the past, for example, through the growth of of onshore wind is that it has contributed, obviously, to that reduction in emissions, but the criticism has been that it hasn't delivered that economic boost that it had the real potential to deliver. So how do we make sure, when it comes to the plan for Grangemouth, that we don't repeat the mistakes of the past? And how will you measure that? Will there be specific measurements within the plan that we will be able to assess whether or not it is a genuine just transition plan?
Yeah, sure. Thank you. So the first part, how does it differ from other plans? How is it the same? It is by its very nature different in that it relates very closely to one area, one complex, one group of people who live and work there. And that is different to the others on energy as it applies to the whole country or transport as it applies to the whole country. So it's place-based, and I know that that's something that the Just Transition Commission have welcomed. There are interconnectivities, though, with the other plans, so they will certainly relate to one another. And we can see that because our economy is interconnected. So we can't have an energy plan which isn't mindful of Grangemouth. We can't have a Grangemouth plan that isn't mindful of transport, given how, I think, 80% of the Central Belt fuel comes from Grangemouth and 100% of aviation fuel comes from Grangemouth. So there will be, there's differences and there are interconnectivities, and we will work through all of them. In terms of monitoring, this is something that I am working quite closely on just now as I've just come into this portfolio, because I think the question of building a just transition is one thing, but how do you know if you've succeeded is another. And I'm sort of working on the theory of that. I suppose practically for Grangemouth, I think our plan, and maybe Andy will want to say more about this because him and I were discussing it yesterday, was that we will have, we need to do that work on the baselining of the economic and the social position at Grangemouth. We will develop the vision for 2045. And once those are in place, we will be able to set out key performance indicators that that monitoring could be had against. So monitoring will be part of it. We are at a very early stage of the development of it, and the two key pieces of work we're undertaking in phase one will inform how we monitor.
So those targets effectively, and that route map, if you like, to monitor those targets will be contained within the plan for Grangemouth when you publish that plan. Is that
I might hand over to Andy on that point, just on when and what we'll publish.
Yeah, so CAPSEC's totally right. When you're talking about our baseline, our vision, the kind of beauty of that is that you're able to benchmark the two, and hopefully what that'll throw up is a series of indicators that we would look to see change over that kind of, the 20 years or so between having the baseline now and the vision in the future. It will produce a series of indicators. And
we're confident that we measure what you want, you will want to measure in that plan. So one of the criticisms in the past has been the government promised 120,000 renewable jobs by 2020, and Fraser Allard did a piece of work recently and concluded there had been 27,000. But one of their criticisms was they had to work out what a renewable job was because we didn't actually measure it. So are you confident that we measure what you will want to have in that plan, or will you have to start to measure new things as well?
I think it's probably a mixture of both. I mean, I don't want to preempt when we go into these conversations to build up a vision that's taken into consideration what industry wants to see, what community wants to see, and what we want to see as government. So some of those things that we will need to start measuring will come out of that workshopping approach to develop that vision. But then there's other things that we can measure just now, such as, you know, green jobs and things like that. I think we will want to measure that too.
I think that's absolutely right, Andy. And I would just add to that that we can't pretend that we know and we can track with absolute certainty everything that's going to happen now out until 2045. So like much of the climate change work and the portfolio, we have to be willing to adapt. We have to treat plans as iterative and learning as we do, actually, because that's the challenge of making policy over 20, 25 years. So your question, you know, will you monitor now and will that change? Yes, we intend to monitor, and Andy has set out how we will do that. But we also have to realise that we have to have scope for adaptation over the next 20, 25 years out to 2045.
And just turning to the wider Energy Just Transition Plan that was published recently. And one of the reasons I asked the question is that there was, I think it's fair to say, quite a lot of criticism of the lack of detail within that plan, not least from your own Just Transition Commission, who weren't consulted on its development. They said, we're deeply concerned about the lack of evidence of adequate policy actions to deliver a just transition for the energy sector, particularly given the urgent need to shift gear in the rest of the 2020s. Friends of the Earth pretty much said it was more of the same, when we know that more of the same won't actually deliver our net zero targets as well. So do you recognise that criticism of the draft Just Transition Plan, that it did lack the detail that we need in order to deliver that just transition that we all want to see?
Yeah, I'm happy to answer that, Convener, although it does stray somewhat out of the remit of this particular session, although I appreciate I have, whilst not being the Energy Secretary, I have responsibility for just transition across government. We mentioned that there were 44 odd recommendations in that, and we are currently considering them and will respond to each of them, and I'll do that jointly with Neil Gray, the Energy Secretary. But I do acknowledge themes about monitoring and evaluation, about engagement, about skills, and the government will actively consider how we can adapt to respond to them.
Okay, thank you. Fiona Hislop to be followed by Maggie Chapman.
Good morning, and thank you for joining us. Can I just follow up a bit on that in relation to who is responsible then for the Just Transition Plan for energy? Who's responsible for the Just Transition Plan for agriculture? Are they the respective other cabinet secretaries with you with oversight, or how does that work? How will that work?
Yeah, it's a really good question. So they will, it's exactly as you described, they will sit with core responsibility for the development of the policy sits with the Cabinet Secretary with that portfolio of responsibility. So Marie Goujon will lead on agriculture and land. Neil Gray will lead on energy. But in the same way that I have responsibility to make sure that all my colleagues are rising to the government's targets for climate change, I also have responsibility to make sure that the just transition work is being how it's being done across government as well. So I like to think of it as finance used to be a portfolio where you were empowered to go across government and see what everyone's doing in their portfolios. Net Zero and Just Transition is very much like that as well.
Okay, thank you. The Just Transition Commission, which is clearly independent, has suggested that effective communication requires co-design of the plans, and it has to be two-way. It's important to demonstrate that clearly, the stakeholder feedback can lead to policy changes. So will you, as the Scottish Government, seek to do this through the co-design process of these just transition plans? And for Grangemouth, who would you define as the stakeholders?
So I'll come back to that point. Just writing it down so I don't forget. I am committed to co-design. As I said, the work that took place in the development of the energy strategy was before my time, but in my coming in we have this new memorandum of understanding in place with us and the Just Transition Commission, which I think has been welcomed by everyone. It speaks to that need for close engagement, to early sight of drafts, and that's how I will expect the plans to be developed going forward, and it's of our benefit to really closely engage with the Just Transition Commission. That's why they have been set up, because they bring that cross civic society knowledge that will make these plans better and more sustainable in the end. So absolutely, early sight of drafts, close engagement. And again, in a similar vein to Mr. Beattie's questions about communities, being able to demonstrate how we have listened and where change has been made.
And the stakeholders?
Oh, the stakeholders, absolutely. So I think comes back to the... So first of all, we have the public sector stakeholders who are important to Grangemouth, all of whom, many of whom, I should say, are already on the Grangemouth Future Industry Board. Other stakeholders are industry, and we have a question, and I think we might come on to this afterwards, about the extent to which they ought to be involved on the Future Industry Board. Then we have workers, their trade unions and communities in and around the area. And I see them, together with Just Transition Commission and the Scottish Parliament, as being key stakeholders.
And can I just check, who's the Cabinet Secretary that's responsible for the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth then?
That's me.
So we welcome that Grangemouth is a place-based approach, but you could see, and others might want to touch on later on about the prospect for the transition for the site itself, the industrial processes, if they can move into the hydrogen sector and the Acorn cluster, etc. But all things being well, and the industry and the industrial site can transition, it could effectively do that in parallel, a separate universe from the community itself. So focusing on the community of Grangemouth, and we know from the previous consultations that they've one of the key aspects and concerns they have is transport, because if everything goes successfully, they're actually looking at expanding jobs at Grangemouth, but that would effectively bring in more cars because the public transport isn't what it kind of should be. There isn't a real link. There has been in the past. So there's quite a serious point about looking at what does success look like, that transport would be absolutely critical, and also housing, because they've also told us that for local businesses that are not on the industrial site, but are businesses within Grangemouth, for them to benefit, to grow, they want to have more of a footfall, which means, you know, making sure people live in the area. And there's also housing challenges, quality of housing to attract people to want to live and stay and spend what we hope will be good wage levels as well. So to what extent do you see the Just Transition Plan addressing these issues, which are actually quite, in a sense, independent of the success of the industrial sites transition, but are absolutely what we already know from the many consultations that have taken place in Grangemouth?
Yes, thank you. I think that's right. I think what the experience of the community can be both independent of what happens at the cluster and deeply connected with it. So both of them have to be borne in mind. And I suppose just a few points. We are at the beginning of this process. I talked about the desire for and my intention that there is very close engagement with the community. And I expect those very issues will come to the fore. So transport in and around, quality of housing and the living experience in and around Grangemouth, how that is now and what it might be as we move into a decarbonised cluster of the future. And our project, our community engagement officer, will be able to feed in those views as they arise in the community. So I can't preempt that that's what will come up, but I think we're right that it will. On transport, I know that a new station at Grangemouth was appraised as part of the STPR2, but wasn't recommended. And that, I think that was owing to the current movement of people in and around the area and from Edinburgh, Glasgow, Stirling, elsewhere into the area. But that's not the only transport issue. We need to think about how well served the communities are by bus and by other means. So I expect all of that will form part of the feedback that we get from the community and our thinking as we develop the plan.
And finally, this is part of the preparation, and we want to input into your plan. So, you know, we're not expecting you to be definitive as to what will be in or not in it, but we're discussing what we've heard. And Colin Smith talked about the need for a route map, but also perhaps tangible points along the way to 2045 and the realising the final vision. One of the things we've heard of actually in terms of transport is congestion around the site because of the many vehicles transporting the high levels of fuel that you've talked about already being key to the central belt of Scotland. So that's an area where there seems to be lack of your ownership or responsibility of who owns that to resolve that. That would be a very quick and easy win. Another one would be looking at the connections north-south from the M8 to Grangemouth. The Avon Gorge Road is the only non-trunk road that is STPR2, and that would stop 40-mile round trips for these self-same big, you know, lorries, tankers, etc. So it's, you know, probably the only green road in Scotland. So in terms of priorities about seeing, you know, wins along the way that are meaningful, whether it's in transport or housing or flooding, whatever ways, these are the things we've heard. So is it possible to make sure that when we produce your plans, I'm not saying it has to be these ones, I would certainly argue that it should be, because I've got a constituency interest in the Avon Gorge Road in particular, but, you know, it makes a wider sense. And I think there needs to be tangible wins that are not just about the industrial site, but for the community around it. Is that something that you expect to be considered over the next, I mean, it's going to be in the next few months, these issues?
Yes, yeah, absolutely. And any of my colleagues can come in if there's anything they want to add in terms of the planning for that. All I can say is that it's my expectation that these issues will, A, be borne out of the discussions that we have with communities, and that when they do, I will expect that we're able to demonstrate how they've been taken into account in the plan. And actually already through the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, which I have to say, again, is a novel approach to public sector coming together of something of such importance as Grangemouth. There's already close working with Falkirk Council, for example, on roads issues and congestion and heavy goods. So, you know, the work is already ongoing, very open to hearing the priorities of the communities, and want to be able to demonstrate how that's been taken into account. And I take absolutely the point about the staging posts, the tangible outcomes at various points along the way that people should be able to expect.
Thank you. Convener?
The Cabinet's... Oh, would you like to come in? Yes, please do.
Yeah, Mike, come in with just one or two extra points. So just building on what the Cabinet Secretary has said, I think you're completely right to bring in that those wider sets of considerations. And I think it was one of the driving factors behind having a Grangemouth site-specific plan alongside the sectoral plans, that there should be mutual learning between those plans. So the coordination on the sectoral side is teaching us what kinds of things we need to prioritise in order to decarbonise sectors. And then Grangemouth will actually bring that into stark relief for us. And I think the sectoral plans will benefit from the Grangemouth plan and vice versa as we go along. I just wanted to touch also on a previous point you made around co-design and learning the lessons from the Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan. And again, building on what the Cabinet Secretary said, I think what we've done is learn from the feedback of the Just Transition Commission, particularly around that co-design point. And we're going to be approaching the new sectoral plans in a rather different way, which is bringing out discussion papers before we bring out draft transition plans. The discussion papers will be much shorter, much more accessible to a wider range of people, and we'll have some analysis and some guidance as to what we're looking to achieve, but without trying to predetermine those outcomes too much. And that will actually make the co-design process more meaningful. We've also engaged with the Just Transition Commission very early on those discussion papers, and we've been able to take into their account their feedback to us in terms of the structure of those papers and what should be highlighted. And then also that's prompted us to think about the analysis that we'll need to underpin each of those transition plans when they are published. So I think Professor Ski has acknowledged that we have started along the right road to make those improvements, and clearly we'll want to build on that relationship as we go along.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you. Before I move to Maggie Chapman, the Cabinet Secretary might be interested to know that we did an inquiry into town centres and retail last year, and I think some of the findings in that would be relevant to Grangemouth, so yourself and the team might want to have a look at that. Maggie Chapman to be followed by Jamie Hampel-Johnson.
Thanks very much, Ken. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary and panel. Thank you for joining us this morning. I was going to bring up the place-based town centre inquiry, because I think there is something about seeing the place as a whole and not just those different sectors coming together. The place is more than just all of those sectors coming together. So I don't underestimate the challenge that Katrina, you've just spoken about, that Grangemouth bringing those sectoral plans into sharp relief. If I can just also follow up briefly on some of the points Fiona was making around community engagement and that co-design work. I think these, and I appreciate what's been said on this co-design and that engagement with the Just Transition Commission, but I think there's also something around including communities and workers in that co-design process in a meaningful way that doesn't just channel those views through the Just Transition Commission, where people might think they get lost a little bit. And I'd urge the Scottish Government to think about co-leadership and co-ownership of different elements of the plans, different elements of delivery and implementation approaches that we take. And I think this is particularly important when we are looking long term, CabSec, you said, you know, very clearly we're not thinking short term chunks of time here. If the community and workers own it, they are invested in it and will make it work for 2045. You know, rather than just involving them in the process, actually giving them ownership of that process, that is a difference. And it's scary, I think, because it's not something that government does often or regularly. But I think that really, really is important. And I suppose from that we will get not only the questions around transport and housing that Fiona has highlighted, but other infrastructure needs of the local area, like the flood prevention plan and that kind of thing, and other environmental infrastructure needs. And I just wondered how you saw the plan being able to take account of those issues that don't speak directly to the energy issues of Grangemouth or the chemical industries that happen there, but actually speak to community more broadly. I just wondered if you could comment on that.
Yes, of course, and I agree. This Grangemouth, the cluster, the people that live there, the public sector bodies, they are, you know, the whole thing is much greater than the sum of its parts. Mm. So whilst I'm sort of breaking them down in order to demonstrate the way that we're engaging, I appreciate it is more than the sum of its parts. I take on board the point about co-ownership and co-leadership. I think it's really important, because when it comes to change, changes can be frightening. Mm. And the more that the people who are involved or impacted by that change are empowered to lead it, to design it, to be responsible for its working, the more sustainable and successful it will be. And I think about that, you know, that's a core concept to me as it applies in Just Transition, but equally in a lot of the work that we're seeking to do to rise to the climate emergency right across government. And we can all think, I think, of a few examples that are pertinent just now on that. I suppose I've talked before about the fact that I need to have the feedback from all of the interested parties, be it transport, be it housing, be it flooding, be it employment, the industry's views, before I can say with the surety that I would want to bring to committee exactly how that will be taken forward into the plan. But I think if I can just come back again to that phase one work that's very much underway, it's about that vision for 2045 on the basis of close consideration of the economic and social issues there just now. But I'm afraid it's difficult for me to say just now exactly what the issues will be and how they'll be built in.
No, I appreciate that. And I do appreciate that this is the start of the process for this plan. I think, I suppose, linked to that, and it's really just to get a sense of how you see some of the connections with the bits of life that are beyond the industrial sectors of the cluster, the bits of life around, you know, schooling, around that transport piece. Well, I think you mentioned, you know, people coming in from Stirling, Edinburgh, mm. Glasgow, around the place. And I suppose if we could, in the Just Transition Plan for Grangemouth, crack what I think we failed to deliver, or what grew out of, for example, the energy sector in the northeast, which is where something I'm much more familiar with in Grangemouth, where we got a two-tier economy. We got those involved directly in the energy sector did very, very well, and the rest of the community, Torrey, for instance, to the south of Aberdeen, pretty much left behind. Mm-hmm. And I think we've already heard elements in this inquiry about bits of that coming into or being people's experience, and people who have nothing to do with Grangemouth cannot be left behind, just, you know, nothing to do with the cluster, but who live okay. in and around Grangemouth cannot be left behind. I'm just curious to see how engagement with communities and workers, because it's workers in other sectors that are nothing to do with Grangemouth, again, as the energy cluster, how you see that working through yeah. this plan.
No, absolutely. And again, I would just say that one of the most important things that we will do in bringing all that together is setting that vision for 2045. So it will say to the people employed, the people working, the people with investments, the energy security needs of the country, what does the Grangemouth area and cluster look like when we hope to reach net zero mm-hmm. by 2045? And that is not, that could never just be emissions reduction to the exclusion of everything else. It has to be what it's like, you know, working there, living there, and what Grangemouth continues to service for Scotland. And I come back to that sort of tripartite of issues for Grangemouth, which is its economic importance, mm-hmm. its importance to people who work there, people who live in and around it, and its impact on the environment. And those are the three key strands that vision has to cover, and they will be developed with hand in hand with people who are affected by it. And I think at this early stage, that's all I can really say, unless there's anything that officials would like to add. It's those three key points and a vision for how we get there built in collaboration with the people affected.
OK, thanks. I know others want to come in on more worker-focused questions.
OK, thank you. Jamie Harker-Johnson to be followed by John Mason.
Thanks very much. Good morning, Cabinet Secretary, and to the committee, as the witnesses as well. I wanted to ask about SMEs. We know that they face particular costs and challenges and barriers to just transition, such as resources and training and the like. We know that 21% don't have a plan going forward, and I imagine awareness amongst the SME sector is probably quite limited. So how can the Scottish Government support, firstly, increase awareness, but also support SMEs in that? And also, as a second kind of part of that, how can that be done in a way that provides or strengthen a Scottish supply chain to do so? Because this is an issue that's come up a number of times in a number of different areas around just transition and other sides as well.
Thank you. I think that's a really important question. First of all, I completely sympathise that. Again, it comes back to that fact that we are seeking change quickly, and there are certain size of organisations that are able to absorb that and to keep up to date with it, and there are certain size of organisations who are not as well placed to focus on those issues outside of just their own bottom line and keeping in business. And Liam mentioned a lot of the pressures that are bearing down on the cost of doing business just now. So we absolutely recognise that. I think there is a need here to be clear that the big emitters at the cluster are the ones that require our focus first and foremost, because they're the big industry businesses and they are the big emitters, and we should not underestimate the task of having to drive down the emissions in the way that's required of them. But that's not to say that SMEs won't play a really important part in this. They will. And I think you touched on it when you said that the supply chain is the really key part. So, there's two touch points that I think are really important for SMEs in this plan. Firstly, it is as we decarbonise the big industry, the supply chains that are connected with that will be vital to small and medium-sized enterprises, and we must engage them on that. And then the other point is just to say that smaller businesses proximate to the cluster are stakeholders in its development, and they should also be part of the planning.
Okay. I mean, in a number of meetings I've had, not with regards to just transition, but on other areas where Scottish Government is acting, on DRS and on short-term lets and things like that, you know, a lot of the time there's support there for the principle, maybe not so much on short-term lets, but on DRS. Mm. One of the concerns that comes up time and time again is engagement, that either they're engaged with too late in the process or they're not really engaged with at all. So how do you make sure that, how are you making sure that SMEs are involved in the process right from the beginning, so that, you know, further down the line when they do become more of a focus rather than the larger emitters, you know, it's done in the right way?
Yeah, absolutely. So we will engage with SMEs. I do have to come back just to that point that I made initially, which is that we have to be quite clear about the fact that we have to start with engagement with the large businesses, large emitters, because that's where the real challenge lies. But I absolutely expect SMEs to be engaged as part of the plan, as I say, because of the supply chain work that we need to do, and also because if any of them are based in the area, they have a stake in that. And I should just add that my colleague, Richard Lockhead, who previously who brought a lot of this work to where it is just now, is now the Minister for Small Business, and I'll be engaging with him on how he expects and what he can do to support me in the development of this.
Okay, have I got time for one brief question?
You do, yes.
Yeah, just very quickly, slightly pivoting. Obviously, Scottish National Investment Bank have said there's less money available for some of the oil and gas companies, and I appreciate that. That may seem logical to some extent in terms of the just transition, but obviously they're still going to play a massive part. So do you have any concerns about how that might impact on their ability? You know, this is still a vital sector. There's still going to be a major role for fossil fuels going forward. So how do you see that might impact on their ability to play the most active part in this transition?
Sorry, can I just clarify SNB's role or the oil and gas industry?
The impact of less funding basically being available to some of the oil and gas sector in their role in the just transition. So it's really the sector and the lack of funding available.
So from what I can see in my experience, for example, of speaking with INEOS and some other companies, is that there is funding available, be that within oil and gas companies who are increasingly referring to themselves as, you know, energy companies because they are diversifying. There is funding there. And for our part in government, as we said earlier, what we can do is set the direction of travel, set the regulatory environment, give confidence, and I think, as Liam quite rightly pointed out, provide the... It's not seed funding, but it's a small proportion of funding to back up what the companies are seeking to do.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you. John Mason, to be followed by Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks very much, Convener. It's a pleasure to be at the committee today. As the Cabinet Secretary probably knows, I am a substitute member, so I'm not been involved in this quite as much. But quite a lot of interesting stuff, and particularly in relation to the workforce. And I suppose then we're thinking both of direct employees, but also contractors and people who are a little bit further away from the main players. I am picking up that there's a certain amount of concern from some circles. And I take the point that was made that there's to be, you've met with the unions and there's an engagement officer. But for example, in the GMB evidence, it said a just transition is happening to workers, not with workers. So how would you react to that?
First of all, I would say that the point about the workforce and the extent to which that's made up by permanent workers and agency workers is a really important point. When I was at Grangemouth last week, we discussed how there's an estimated 2,000 full-time equivalent jobs at the cluster, but they can employ up to 2,000 more contractors and actually... up to 7,000 at peak times when there are maintenance work to be done. So that complicates the picture, and it means that we have to rise to that challenge. So I mentioned the baseline study that we're doing as part of phase one that will map the extent to which the workforce is made up. It will clarify those figures, basically. And there's another bit of work that we will do alongside that, and it's currently going on within the Future Industry Board, and Liam might want to say more about it, but it's a skills audit. So it's us working with Skills Development Scotland via the board, and it's basically looking at existing skills and alongside that looking at what the future needs might be as we make the decarbonisation journey that we are on. So I think those two bits of work, where we are now, together with the skills audit, will give us a really good picture to rise to some of that. And of course, trade unions will be absolutely critical to that. And I don't want anyone to feel that the transition is being done to them. It must happen with them.
So, Mr. Middleton.
Thank you. Only a couple of comments to supplement what the Cabinet Secretary has said. So, Mr. Mason, you're absolutely right to cite the GMB evidence, but the Unite's written response to the committee's calls for views was quite positive in terms of the engagement that they are seeing with the Scottish Government and indeed the UK Government to date on just transition planning and at Grangemouth. And they actually said that, you know, that could perhaps be a model for other exercises going forward. So I think that's quite positive. Just on that theme of positivity, if you speak to the workforce, particularly the immediate cluster, And I know that you heard from representatives earlier in the committee process. They are so passionate about the role and their capabilities going forward as you move from fossil fuels and petrochemicals into lower carbon opportunities. And I don't think we should underestimate that. And then finally, we have, through the Engagement with the Future Industry Board, as the Cabinet Secretary mentioned, we have a dedicated skills workstream, which is led by experts at Skills Development Scotland and a social enterprise spun out of the local area called Fuel Change. And what they have done already is they have commissioned Optimat, the sort of sector experts, to prepare a skills analysis of the Grangemouth cluster, so trying to really get some detail on the existing skills and capability. Now, we know that there's world-leading expertise there, but that's quite notional. We'd like to get some evidence to support that into our decision-making and policy-making. And I think once that report's back with us, we're expecting around June time, I think that might be quite helpful for the committee's consideration.
So are we clear that if workers need reskilling to some extent, even though they're highly skilled, they will need some reskilling, that who is going to take that forward? Is it going to be they themselves personally, or is it the present employer, or is it somebody else? And then secondly, I think, again, one of GMB's concerns, which is a bit wider, but which I share, is that for young people coming through to the job market, are we placing enough emphasis on practical skills and apprenticeships, or are the schools still putting too much emphasis on the academic side?
Yeah, so I think on the first part of your question, in terms of who is responsible for that sort of upskilling or reskilling, I think that'll be a combination of government, SDS is our skills industry, and the business themselves. And I think there's different degrees in terms of how much upskilling is required. So I know when one of the NEOS representatives presented to the committee earlier on, I think there's a real passion and confidence that if you can maintain those assets on site today with the right training and instruction manuals, you'll be able to do that in the future. So I think they're less concerned about that sort of skills gap there. And I think that's something that we are quite supportive of and think that with the right support from us, SDS and government, they'll be able to take forward. Okay.
And younger people coming through?
Oh, sorry, the younger people point. Just two points, and maybe Catriona might want to come in. I think the immediate cluster is already feeling relatively optimistic in that regard. So I think there's about 40 apprenticeships at the moment at the NEOS site. Really high subscription rates in terms of applying for those apprentices. They're highly sought after. And I mentioned that organisation Fuel Change earlier, which co-leads our skills workstream. That is an entity that is designed with its primary purpose to engage young people in the transition and how you bring them through education into training into the workforce. And I think that their sort of ethos is that it's the young people themselves that have got the energy, the skills and the knowledge to try and drive that change in the business community, and that's what they're trying to do. But I don't know if any of my colleagues want to expand on the young people point.
Yeah, could I add a couple of points? So just kind of stepping back from Grangemouth for a moment and looking at the wider energy industry. As part of the Energy Strategy and Just Transition Plan, we commissioned Ernst & Young to do an analysis of the oil and gas industry as it currently is. And part of that was to do with the opportunity for jobs in the future. And they concluded that there was, if we get it right, if we can maximise the opportunities of renewable energy, there is a possible opportunity for quite a serious expansion of jobs up to 77,000 jobs in the future. But that is firstly an opportunity, but secondly a challenge, because it does require the very skilled workforce that currently work in the energy industries to be able to reskill, as you say. But it also means that we've got to maximise the young people coming through who will currently be in primary school, some of them, into the industry. And I think in terms of responsibilities, your question about that, it has to be a huge collaboration to get that right. I was speaking to the chief executive of Scottish Power 2 weeks ago, who was talking about the strong workforce planning that he is needing to do now in order to be getting the right skills up through working with colleges and working with apprenticeship schemes. And I think that will be true across the industry. And I think the other point, though, is that there are workers in oil and gas at the moment who really do want to reskill and who want to go into renewable energy, but there are too many barriers in their way at the moment. And I think one of the roles of government there can be to work across with people like the Global Wind Organization to try to reduce those barriers by thinking about how some skills can be seen as transferable from one industry to another, because there can be silos that are built up that are artificial. So I think we're working with APITO at the moment to try and break down some of those barriers, including through a skills passport. But I don't think we're yet doing enough. I think there's more we have to do to build on that.
I realise it's an early stage in the process. I just wanted to touch on one other area, which was other parts of the public sector, for example, planning and consenting regimes, which I think would be mainly local authorities. Mr. Middleton already mentioned the US subsidies, which are kind of competing with us. And I think planning would be another area where if another country gives planning permission more quickly than we're able to, it might attract jobs there. So can you give us a kind of reassurance that other parts of the public sector, like Scottish Enterprise, like local authorities, are really on board for this?
Yes, happy to. And I think it's a really important point. And I should say, when I visited Cluster last week, I also met with Forth Ports, and planning and the speed of consenting and comparisons with their experience elsewhere were raised with me. And I think it's always going to be a balance between speed of consenting versus any risk of deregulation. And we have to get that right. And the change that we're going to see over the next 10, 20 years, I think, puts pressure on us as government to consider all of that and how quickly it can work. The point about public sector, so again, I come back to the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, a really novel approach, bringing the public sector bodies together. On that, we have Scottish Government, Falkirk Council, Scottish Enterprise, Transport Scotland, SEPA, Skills Development Scotland, Forth Valley College. And we're now that we've done that, we will consider bringing industry in. So already in that group, you can see how something like planning, where we have Scottish Government around the table, where we have Falkirk Council around the table, that's going to help us to, and it already has helped us, to shortcut some of these issues that arise, where we all have different responsibilities. And the second point on planning that I would briefly mention is MPF4 and the inclusion of Grangemouth being recognised as an industrial green transition zone. I think that was probably something that the Grangemouth Future Industry Board worked on and were successful in achieving. And that will, by being in the MPF4 and by MPF4 being made part of the development plan, that should, I hope, give the certainty and hopefully the speed of consenting that I think industry not only want to see but actually need to see if we're to make the change that we need to over the next wee while.
Thanks, Camilla.
Thank you. Just a couple of points for bringing in Gordon MacDonald. Just for clarification, the committee haven't heard from a representative from INEOS. We did have a trade union representative who came from the plant, but INEOS themselves have not given evidence to the committee as a panel. And secondly, just to pick up on the Grangemouth Future Industry Board, the committee were really keen to hear from the board, but our understanding is it's not really a board, it's more a forum. And so some of the issues that you talked about in terms of they're looking at roads or looking at planning, you know, we were quite keen to engage with them, but they haven't been a body that see themselves. They don't have representatives as such. So I don't know if that's... we have struggled a wee bit with the understanding of their purpose, okay, and how they relate to us as a parliamentary committee. And I think the Cabinet Secretary seems to hold the responsibility to speak on behalf of the board. Would that be correct? Or
no, I don't... I don't think that is correct. So first of all, I think that the industry board wrote to the committee. They gave writing in evidence. My colleague Andy Hogg, who's a deputy director within the Scottish Government, he's one of the co-chairs. He really wanted to be here today, and that's why we asked if we could change the timings, but that wasn't possible. But my colleague Liam is also part of it, so he'll probably be able to say more about the constitution of it and potentially who's the spokesperson for it. I mean, I think I'm probably more concerned with the work that they're doing rather than who the spokespeople are.
Well, but Cabinet Secretary, we were concerned about the work we're doing, but we couldn't get anybody to engage with us directly here on what the work is. We did receive a paper briefing, but we were actually keen to take evidence, and it's been a bit piecemeal. So And we do appreciate there was another official who was due to come, and we do understand the reasons why he's not here. That's totally understandable.
And he's a really key part of GFIB as well, which we were hoping he could come. But
I think just a couple of comments, and hopefully this clarifies. The board in itself isn't a sort of legal entity. It's a combination of the Scottish Government and all of our public sector partners, and we'll discuss about how we're bringing business into that. But it's not unusual for government to form a board to sort of solve problems or take forward long-term planning. So that's what the Engagement with Future Industry Board seeks to do. I mean, I head up the team that provides the secretariat to that board, so I'm more than happy to take any and all questions on the board today. That was also part of the reason we sought to put forward what I hoped was quite comprehensive written evidence on behalf of the board to assist the committee in your inquiry. So that response to the calls for views sets out the genesis of GFIB, why it was constituted, its priorities, its work plan, and for 2023-2024, the sort of two main primary drivers of that work plan is firstly, deciding the right model to bring in industry to be active participants in the board now that we have effectively got a much more streamlined and coordinated public sector. And then secondly, to drive the delivery of that just transition plan as the Cabinet Secretary set out. And we've got strategic work streams across the board. So we have work streams that look at the just transition to net zero. So we have officials that drive that work, and that will deliver the just transition plan. I mentioned we have a skills work stream earlier, so that's led by experts at SDS and fuel change. We also have an infrastructure work stream, and what that does is that unites Falkirk Council and Scottish Futures Trust as our infrastructure agency. We have a work stream on project development, which is led by Scottish Enterprise and SDI. And then we have a regulatory hub, which looks to, whilst we're ensuring regulatory compliance at the site with colleagues at SEPA, also try and promote innovation in regulatory practices. So essentially what the board does is it's a forum. It coordinates government and our public sector's wider activity. It tries to sort of unify all the senior decision makers in the one direction to plan for a net zero Grangemouth. So I think perhaps some of that confusion could have been borne out of sort of perhaps viewing the board as a legal entity or something that's constituted in its own right, as a combination of the public sector to work as that forum to try and deliver a net zero Grangemouth.
And it is new in that regard, isn't it? So it's probably not surprising that you're wondering how exactly it works and what it is, because it's quite a novel approach.
Okay, and there is an intention now to bring business onto that board. That was one of the...
Yeah, so... Just a couple of comments on that, if I'm making a meaner. So I wouldn't want there to be any sort of perception that the board has not engaged with businesses. So to give you a sense of the structure, all of the eight major businesses at the cluster are account managed by Scottish Enterprise. All of those account managers feed into the board to give us that intelligence. The original purpose was to sort of coordinate and sort of get our arms around all the public sector activity. And I think just a couple of weeks ago, when you heard from bankers from Net Zero, they were saying that actually getting that coordination through the public sector is absolutely critical, and that's what this board tries to do. And then finally, in terms of business representation, we publish our minutes. The board has a web page. The minutes from December talk about the next phase of the board being how do we best secure active industry participation. And when the Cabinet Secretary was out meeting two of the larger corporations at Grangemouth and INEOS and Forthports last week, we asked them in terms of, how willing would you be to engage in the board directly, and receive positive responses. So now that we've got those work streams in place, we've got the right resources and the people across the public sector, I think the next phase is to try and bring in business to the forum directly.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald, followed by Graeme Simpson.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. I wanted to ask you about the ACON project and the Scottish cluster. So the Scottish Government has previously highlighted that the ACON project is a vital part of the strategy to reduce industrial emissions in Scotland. Can you update the committee on how important the ACON project is in supporting the transition to net zero, and what discussions are taking place with the UK Government in moving this project forward?
Yeah, that's a really important point. So the Scottish Government, you're quite right, believe and consider carbon capture and storage to be absolutely vital to the net zero plans. This is backed up by our statutory advisers on climate change, the Committee on Climate Change, whose advice is that it's a necessity, not an option. You couple with that the fact that Scotland is exceptionally well placed to have CCUS functioning across the country. most particularly, of course, feeding into Acorn at St Fergus. It was an inexplicable decision for the UK government not to include Acorn in the Track 1 process. I think that was certainly my view. It was a view shared by people across the political spectrum and, importantly, outside of the political spectrum that was inexplicable. But we do welcome UK government's confirmation that Acorn can form part of Track 2. What exactly we are trying to establish now is when that will close so that we can understand and track how and when CCUS, as such an important component of our net zero planning, can come on stream in Scotland. And it's linked with Grangemouth in many ways because it's a core part of their sustainability plan as well.
In 2021, Net Zero Teesside was awarded Track 1 status and was named the UK's leading carbon capture scheme and was awarded a slice of the UK government's £1 billion funding. That was despite the UK government's Department of Business and Trade highlighting on their website that Scotland is helping lead the way on this work, benefiting from cutting-edge R&D activities, a talented workforce and a significant geographical advantage. And it goes on to say the North Sea also has enough CO2 storage capacity to support the UK's demands for hundreds of years. Yesterday, Shell pulled out of the Teesside scheme, following National Grid pulling out on Sunday, and Shell has said that they will now focus on the Acorn scheme in Scotland, where it will act as technical developer. Given this news, what further pressure can the Scottish Government put on the UK Government to reconsider funding for the Acorn project, and when do you expect to hear any announcement about funding?
Yep, again, I agree with much of what you've said, Mr MacDonald. It is, you know, what you read initially from the UK Government's own comments made clear that Acorn and Scotland is uniquely well placed to lead the way on CCUS with skills, with capacity, with existing infrastructure. And I think that's why the decision over Track 1, and you know, I'm deliberately using that word, inexplicable. I don't understand that. I'm not alone in not understanding why that didn't come to pass. But we have to welcome progress as and when it arises, and their indication that Acorn can be part of Track 2 is good. The clarity that we're now seeking, and I'm seeking it, my colleague Neil Gray is seeking it, is exactly when that will close, and we want it to close in short order so that we can get on with doing in Scotland what we think we ought to have been doing before now.
Okay, and my final point is, it was mentioned earlier that if we get this right, there's a possibility of 77,000 jobs. Mm-hmm. If the Acorn project in the Scottish cluster doesn't get UK government funding, how many of those 77,000 jobs are going to be at risk?
It's a really good question, but I don't have the figure to hand. But I would be more than happy to go away, look at the Ernst & Young funding and maybe come back. Although I wonder, Liam, did you want to add anything to that?
Yeah, so just a couple of points. So on that Ernst & Young analysis, what that did was it looked at oil and gas energy generation and mapped that across to low carbon, and it was that low carbon energy generation that gave that 77,000 figure. And there's a combination of onshore, offshore wind, hydrogen and CCUS, so we can get the breakdown and of how many jobs that would generate and give that back to you, Ms MacDonald. I think the larger point that I would really want to reiterate is that we have a sort of world-renowned petrochemicals cluster in Grangemouth, with huge entities that have committed over £1 billion to get to net zero. That project is critical to realising that investment. I think if you can give Scotland's industry the opportunity to capture, transport and safely store its CO2, yeah, we could have a real competitive advantage. So, as its Cabinet Secretary says, we are doing all we can to call on the UK Government to bring forward the action we require them to do at pace so that investment can be executed.
Okay, thanks very much.
Thank you. I've had a request from Chris Brisland to contribute. Chris, would you like to come in?
Yes, thank you. I just wanted to clarify on some of the timelines on the sort of cluster sequencing process at UK government. So The intention is that the Track 2 process is now open. So UK government are inviting expressions of interest up until the 28th of this month. So this week that process closes. And the ACORN project doesn't have to submit an expression of interest because they deem it already having met the criteria. In a Grangemouth perspective, you know, it's absolutely critical that this project gets the go-ahead. The potential for carbon reductions, you know, from this combined with hydrogen investment, you know, is circa 1 million tonnes of CO2, and it forms a core part of, you know, INEOS's, you know, 2030 roadmap to net zero. So, you know, as Scottish Government, there's been lots of pressing of UK Government, and there remains an active dialogue with officials in UK Government about trying to secure that status.
Thank you. Graeme Simpson.
Thanks very much, Convener. I'm delighted we heard from Chris Bryceland there. I was feeling rather sorry for him. So I've got a follow-up question for Chris. Do we know, have the UK government actually set a timescale for making a decision on this? I don't know the answer to that. Perhaps you do.
That's the million-dollar question, Mr. Simpson. The timetable has not yet been published, and that's what we're really pressing for, is certainty over timescale, because that's the really critical bit in unlocking, you know, the significant private sector investment that will follow. You know, why are you know, companies like INEOS interested in this? You know, it gives them certainty around, you know, being able to secure sort of business model support through both that, you know, industrial CCS business models, but also that opens up the hydrogen business model support that, you know, is going to provide subsidy essentially to, you know, producing hydrogen at scale on site.
Thanks for that. I've got a few questions which arise from the session we've already had, and then I've got a couple of ones that haven't been asked already. So going back to the plan that you hope to produce, I'm just wondering, obviously you can't tell us what's going to be in the plan, I understand that, but I just wonder the sort of level of detail that might be in it. Are you going to, you know, set out, we hope to do this by then, or, you know, I mean, going back to Fiona Hislop's question about transport, would it be in that sort of level of detail, we will fix this road or that road, or is it just going to be aspirational?
So the straightforward answer is I can't answer that just now with the, as I said earlier, the surety that I would want to bring to committee, because we're still developing all. I would hazard a guess that we wouldn't go. Well, no, I'm not going to actually. I don't want to, because I don't want to create a hostage to fortune on any of that, because I have laboured the point this morning that what people tell us they want to see is going to be important here. So I don't want to start preempting exactly how the plan will be formed.
Well, you're quite right not to make it up as you go along. Can I just check? I just want to double check on the makeup of the Grangemouth Future Industries Board. And Liam, and indeed Cabinet Secretary, you both alluded to getting the private sector more involved. Is that going to be, are you actually going to ask for people to join the board, or just, as you said, Liam, engage with the board?
Well, I think it will be more of the former, so it will be joining the board in some capacity. We are doing a piece of work just now to actually work out, well, what is the most appropriate model for doing that. You see other examples around Europe where clusters sort of start to form as a sort of helix between industry, academia and government in sort of equal parts. So that's something we're giving active consideration to just now. There will be perhaps certain discussion points that business may want government to sort out first with the public sector and sort of present a united front. I think that's fair. But to the extent that businesses are willing to engage and be at the table and delivering a just transition plan that's credible for them, I think myself, the Cabinet Secretary and our team want them to be a huge part of that conversation with us, and with meaningful representation on the board.
Yeah, OK, that's really good. Cabinet Secretary, you've obviously visited the site as we have, and you mentioned earlier that you mentioned aviation fuel, which is already produced there. But one of the big, it's a big opportunity, I think, for Grangemouth and Scotland in producing sustainable aviation fuel. And I wonder if you discussed that with INEOS when they were there. And what do you think needs to happen in order for SAF, as it's called, to be produced at Grangemouth, which would be a massive opportunity for Scotland?
Yep, I'm happy to answer that, and I'm happy to answer it in the context of the discussion I had with Grangemouth about their sustainability plan. But I do have to caveat that with the fact that I'm not the Energy Secretary, and therefore I am not involved on a day-to-day basis on, for example, the development of hydrogen policy, CCUS, sustainable aviation. My role in government will be to make sure that the Energy Secretary is having those discussions and is supported to do so. But I would say that there are generally three ways, I think, as far as I can tell, that industry can decarbonise and rise to the net zero challenge. One is making their industrial processes more efficient. Another is switching to low carbon fuels. And the third one is capturing carbon, which we have discussed. And when I was with INEOS, they took me through their sustainability plan, linked as it is to the government's 2045. And we talked about their £350 million investment in a more efficient energy plant at the centre of the complex, a £500 million upgrade to the Forties pipeline system, their plans for CCUS, their interest in sustainable fuels. But in terms of my understanding as an engineer and from a technical point about the production of sustainable aviation fuels, I think I'll leave it there on that one in particular. But Liam, maybe, you know, with your role in critical infrastructure, maybe you've got more to add to that.
Yeah, just one or two very brief points. So I'm aware of the sort of the aviation cross-party group and your interest in that. And I think we see it as potentially a huge market opportunity for Grangemouth. And we're starting to see across the downstream oil and gas sector across Europe moving that way. So looking at low carbon fuels, looking at biofuels, but particularly sustainable aviation fuel. We are speaking with the sector on the feasibility of deploying that in Scotland. And in terms of barriers, I think there are a couple that's worth citing quickly. You have to look at getting the right feedstocks for sustainable aviation fuel. Yeah. And engaging with the sector as a whole and its supply chain on how we can realise the correct feedstocks for those processes. We have to ensure that if you're asking businesses to invest in that new technology and that new sort of product pipeline, there's sufficient market demand for it. Now, at the moment, Grangemouth provides all of our aviation fuel in Scotland, but at the moment, not all airports in Scotland are placing orders for sustainable aviation fuel, so that's something we'll have to look at. And then thirdly, I think there's a piece around commercialisation. So you'll be aware, Mr Simpson, the price of sustainable aviation fuel or SAF is some way off current kerosene and jet fuel. So yeah. Any sort of market mechanisms working with the UK government that can be put in place to close that commercialisation gap, I think would be really welcomed.
Yeah, you're completely right. But it's, I mean, I think this does relate to just transition, because I think you and Neil Gray have to work closely on this, and with the UK government. But if once we start producing SAF in greater numbers, the price comes down. Scotland's airports can benefit because airlines will go there because they've got, you know, SAF is available there. Huge opportunity. And also think the UK government, and by the way, the Aviation Cross-Party Group did send its report on this to both governments. I think we're still waiting to hear back from both. So that would be useful to get. I'll move on to hydrogen, because that's been mentioned. Cabinet Secretary, you were quoted in one of the papers, the Herald, I think, saying you think that hydrogen could be a major export for Scotland. What did you base that on?
Well, I based it on the work that was done to produce our final hydrogen plan, which was published 14 December 2022. It sets out the government's strategic approach and the actions that we think are required in order to harness our capacity to produce hydrogen, both to service our own domestic needs, but equally to be an export opportunity for Scotland, in order to service the needs of countries across Europe who have to decarbonise their industrial bases, and actually whose industrial bases are far greater than ours here. And so, as I say, we have the plan. It's backed up by £100 million worth of investment that Liam mentioned earlier. And there is a chapter in that plan dedicated to exactly how we build the export market for hydrogen that we know Scotland can. And I would just add, finally, that whilst we have done all that, and whilst we know the potential is there, a great many of the powers, and particularly over the regulatory framework, that are required to really launch Scotland's hydrogen potential, they rest at UK level. So it's another one of my top asks of UK government.
Yeah, well, that's correct. But Jim Ski, who you've mentioned earlier, said he didn't see the evidence to justify your belief. Let's hope you're right and he's not. But your belief that we could be a major exporter of hydrogen and Friends of the Earth called your predictions pie in the sky. So who's right?
So I'll take them to both of those points separately. I understand that there are concerns amongst some stakeholders, Friends of the Earth included, about hydrogen, about green and blue hydrogen and the different ways it's produced, and whether, in their view, they are appropriate in a climate emergency. Scottish Government support both blue and green, incidentally. In terms of Professor Ski's quote, I think I know what you're talking about, and I think he was responding to the draft energy strategy and just transition plan. So whilst I don't know exactly, if Mr. Ski was referring to the energy strategy not explaining exactly how we intend to launch the export market, I would just point Professor Ski to the chapter dedicated to that in our hydrogen plan.
That's what he was referring to.
Yeah.
One more question, because I've been reflecting on what you've been saying throughout this, and the UK government's been mentioned quite a lot. And it just occurs to me that when you're producing this plan for Grangemouth, that maybe they should be involved in some way. You might... I don't know how you feel about that. I mean, they've come up in our discussion today. They clearly have been investing through various schemes in the area. It would seem to me appropriate that they would, you know, maybe be involved at some point.
It's absolutely appropriate. Whilst we are in the UK, and whilst the UK government have powers that are so directly in play here, including over energy, macroeconomic policy, etc., they have a really important role to play in this. Our respective climate targets are absolutely interlinked whilst we're in the UK. So I haven't had it yet. I've only been in post for a couple of weeks, but I have net zero interministerial government meetings, and I would expect that to be a forum where I would raise with my counterparts the issue of this just transition plan and others.
Okay.
I'm going to take some brief supplementaries. Fiona Hislop.
So clearly the green hydrogen potential for Scotland is enormous, but we'll need to have a bridge to get there, and the Econ Cluster is key on that. And the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee cross-party last spring produced a report recommending the importance of that. But bearing in mind that we won't necessarily be able to see that shift to the sustainable aviation fuel, or indeed the big green hydrogen market that we anticipate Scotland could realise for some time, but it will have an impact on the just transition, and particularly for Grangemouth. When you produce the just transition plan, it won't be set in stone, I'm assuming, because there will have to be this every time there's a milestone of an intervention of what we hope will be a positive decision, it will affect it. So will you make clear when you publish next year how you're going to keep it set on an iterative basis, current but also forward-looking and visionary?
Yes, absolutely. I think that's a really well-made point. I tried to make it earlier when I was talking about policy making over the long term. We need technological advance to come to our assistance over the next 20, 25 years. We need UK government to do make the interventions that they require to. So the planning that we put in place has to be able to be responsive to that. So I'll make sure that we, when we present the plan, we're clear about the iterative nature.
Yeah, thank you. And I suppose linked to the question from Ms Hislop about flexibility of the plan or responsiveness of the plan, is the plan will necessarily contain a number of risks and assumptions that will have to be made when you talk about new technology. It is, you know, we're not at the commercial stage yet. It's not certain what will come to our rescue, as you put it. Will there be plan Bs and contingency? Will there be a recognition that that is actually the area we're in? While we can be aspirational and know where we, what we think we need to deliver by 2045, that's not a certainty.
Yes, absolutely. So, and this is, again, it applies here in the development of the Just Transition Plan. It applies in the development of the Climate Change Plan, which we are also working on just now and we'll hope to present a draft of this year. We have to be able to demonstrate that technological advance will come on stream, and we try really hard to present that in different ways so that if there's a degree of certainty, for example, if we have certainty over the closure of Track 2 and Acorn's role within that, we will be able to say, excuse me, with a great deal more certainty, the role that CCUS will play. If, for example, we're talking about agriculture and some of the early stage developments for the capture of methane, for example, in cattle sheds, we have to indicate the, how early in the development of that it is and when we think it might come on stream. So we try to be realistic about the developments that are in play and the timescales at which they might start to reduce Scotland's emissions and contribute towards that those emissions reduction targets.
Good, thank you. Colin Beattie.
Thank you, Commissioner. I just wanted to come in on the back of some comments that Liam Middleton made, and you know, maybe they're daft laddie questions, I don't know, but sustainable aviation fuel, what does that consist of?
So there are different methodologies, if you like, to make sustainable aviation fuel. You can get synthetic fuels, which are made through electrolysis as well, but I think they're some way off. I think in the medium term, we're looking more at bio-based content for sustainable aviation fuel, and I think when you speak to the industry, they see that as more of a realistic, progressive, near-term step. But going back to the question from Mr. Simpson earlier, I think that if you have an asset that provides the majority of or all of Scotland's aviation fuel, and we're starting to see potentially a market feasible pathway to produce a decarbonised product that will be for the benefit of wider Scotland, and also with the right support and incentives provide a commercial opportunity for that asset, I think it's right and promising that the whole sector and government are starting to look at it as perhaps a viable option for them.
Just to follow up there.
Briefly.
Given that we've already got hydrogen fuel planes in the air, where does that fit in?
So I think that if you speak to airlines, they view SAF as a more realistic near-term commercial proposition for them. We are speaking to the downstream sector more broadly in terms of the use of hydrogen in transport. I think when you engage with them, they look more at HGVs in the first instance rather than planes as a sort of commercially viable market opportunity for them. So I think it's more SAF than hydrogen in terms of aviation at the moment, but I can see Mr. Simpson's got his hand up, so I'll give him the floor.
Just remind members, we're not the Transport Committee, but I'll hand over to Graham for a short.
I feel like I've joined the panel to help Mr. Beattie out. I think the simple answer is that hydrogen at the moment cannot be used for larger planes, whereas SAF. The airlines will tell you that SAF could be used. So, you know, it's basically a like-for-like replacement. That's a very simple answer. So, but hydrogen, we're not quite there yet.
It might be something that we can discuss out with the committee.
We can.
That now brings us to the end of the session this morning. Thank you to the Cabinet Secretary and officials for attending, and we'll now move into private session.